Hello everyone and welcome to Frontier Feature, where everything is made up and the points don't matter. No way, that's a different show. Welcome to Frontier Feature, where we offer deep dives into Star Citizen related things and maybe even interview a folk or two, but not today. Today, what we're doing is taking a look at the, well, not so freshly released, but still quite freshly released schedule, production schedule. For Star Citizen Alpha 3.0.
That was a mouthful.
That was a mouthful,
I bet you can't say that backwards.
Can't even say that forward.
But yeah, last week we got a mouthful of information, or should I say several mouthfuls, facefuls? I don't know.
We're a buttload.
Just as bad as you today. But we got... When does a mouthful become a buttload?
You don't want to know, but I'm sure there's an entry for it on Umbra Dictionary.
Oh, geez. Anyway, what a place to start.
Yes, this episode rated M for mature.
What a place to start.
So, I think we should start with what the schedule means for the company and having them basically answer the mother of all questions that should not be asked, which is basically, you know, just every question that starts with when.
Yes.
Yeah. Do you think it's a good idea that I did it?
Well, I mean, I think
we both know just how much trouble they get into by putting a time slot or, you know.
I think that it was inevitable. I mean, like, CIG has had this kind of track record with kind of being open in development. And they have tried before. They've tried and tried and tried. And sometimes it didn't really go the way that they wanted to, or at least, like, the front-facing side of the house said one thing, and then people in the back were, like, running around their hair on fire. You know, remember...
It's like, well, most of the time that happens when, let's say, Chris Roberts gets a bit drunk on a show and just says something that he shouldn't. But this was a coordinated effort across the entire company that took months to do.
So I was comparing it to everybody. Yeah.
Yeah, it's everybody pitching in, making sure that at least the time frames are somewhat reasonable.
Yeah.
Instead of weeks, not months.
Exactly. Yeah. That was what I was comparing it to. I was comparing it to the whole Star Marine debacle of last year, where it was exactly weeks, not months. And eventually they just decided to sweep it under the rug, as it were, and then release it whenever it was ready. But as you mentioned, with how their schedule reports worked and how the previous schedule reports have worked as well, you know, even though those were for much smaller time frames, people within their different schools within the studios gave those dates as, you know, from there, their internal days, as opposed to kind of like when they would like it to come out. They went from being like from talking like a producer with the whole weeks not months thing, where that would have just been like a forced like final product, to kind of like asking their actual member, their staff, hey, when do you think it's going to come out? And then they just put it there as, we'd like it, that we would like for it to come out then. If it doesn't, it doesn't. If it's ready, it is. I think that it's a bold move, Cotton, posting 3.0 schedule, the entirety, all in one go.
Yep.
But, you know, if they manage to keep, you know, I guess keep honest, or at least... if they manage to deliver, then they will gain so much face from everybody. They'll gain so much face. Yeah.
Time-wise, it's not even that long. It's basically from today, day of the recording, it's 2 months and 10 days.
That is for the initial 3.0, but they also released...
That is for the initial...
Yeah.
They did, yeah. That one is slightly more iffy and slightly... further open,
exactly,
I would say.
Exactly.
But still, even the 3.0 schedule, well, it's not really wide, but it's deep. It's still 2 months and 10 days until proposed and hopeful completion. But compared to previous schedule reports, where it was just basically maybe two ships, some bugs and stuff like that, not that extensive a schedule. This one is a mile and a half long.
Yeah, yeah. So they've actually split
all of this stuff. Yeah.
So they've split up this whole schedule report into two. Correct. They split it into the 3.0 schedule, which we're about to talk about, and then the 2017 schedule, which is what you said before, a more overarching kind of like who knows, like feature wish list, basically. If they get even a fraction of the stuff that they've listed in any of this stuff on time, again, I feel like it'll save them so much face. You know, people will forget the whole weeks, not months thing. I mean, it'll just be, I mean, it is already, you know, just a casual meme people throw for fun, you know, like no one really means it anymore. But
Yeah. I think CIG has saved quite a bit of face ever since that. But this will be just making the entire slate blank.
And,
well, even if they do miss it by maybe a month, maybe two, maybe have 3.0 release at Gamescom.
Yeah. So again, Gamescom is their world stage. And so it'd be nice.
Yes.
And this schedule report has not gone unnoticed from all those video game outlets as well. Gamescom actually released an article on this schedule report. And thankfully, I mean, like I say thankfully, like I work for CIG, but thankfully it was a very objective piece. It was just saying what it is and what it entails.
Gamescom or?
GameSpot.
GameSpot, yes. Right, that one. Yeah, GameSpot is maybe somewhere in between the non-biased and biased sites from my experience.
Right.
But yeah, and they were very unbiased and very also quite hopeful because they, I think, whoever wrote that article also appreciates all the effort and that went into not just creating the schedule, but understands what the schedule means. So with that out of the way, I think we should maybe start with things that are already completed in the 3.0.0 branch.
Okay.
That is all the stuff that you can read on the normal, the old page, the robotspaceindustries.com/schedule-report page. Before everything starts, there is a huge sexy section of things already complete in 3.0.0 branch. So the first one being render target refactor that I have no idea what it means.
So wait, render target refactor?
Yes.
So
it's not going to be over there.
Okay.
At least it's going to be somewhere down below.
Right. Okay.
Yes.
So you wanted to go over.
Yes, because this is everything.
Uh-huh.
You know, it's a very nice thing, but it's all real-time tracking, so to speak.
Yes.
But I'm going over the what CIG has released. They say it saves over 50% of the video memory previously used for dynamic textures.
Okay.
So it's good. Well, that's a stupid thing to say.
What do you mean? It's a stupid thing to say.
I mean, they wouldn't have put something on there that wasn't good. We're just gonna put some feature into the game that does nothing to benefit the game, but it increases the, I don't know, loading times by 15%.
Right.
They're not gonna do that. So you know, everything is good.
I mean, it speaks to, I guess, the task now of kind of optimizing all the features and back end stuff that they put into. Into the development, right? You know, like the game runs okay right now, but you know, you try and go into the universe and it's so all this optimization, you know, like making things 50% more efficient, you know, like yes please, this and netcode stuff and all that kind of stuff will add to making the game what we playable, you know, what we want it to be.
And yeah, this is, from what I remember, this is something to do with, HUD, for instance, because the HUD on the helmet is a drawn texture. It's not an overlay. So that these sort of dynamic textures, and maybe this will even open a window to multi-window rendering. So you can have, like, if you have a, like a video screen on the dashboard of your ship, and a video comes in, that this sort of tech is what this makes more efficient.
Right.
I think. Yeah.
Okay.
Next up, physically based area lights.
Physically based area lights. Okay, so what does that mean to the layman? Because it's nice, you know, saying all these like fancy terms, and then like,
yeah,
I'm like,
I know, and yeah. I wish they actually explained something there, but mm-hmm. they didn't. So I'm guessing it's something to do with they talked about it on ATV 2 or 3 episodes ago.
Mm-hmm.
About how they can make lights of different shapes,
right?
And that will accurately cast shadows, like area shadows, soft shadows, mm-hmm. and reflections. Because before, okay, maybe the object that casts a light was a certain shape, but the actual entity that casts light in the engine had to be either a point or a sphere,
right?
So even if you had like a rectangular screen that was illuminating something, mm-hmm. the actual light source had to be a sphere, which was odd.
Okay.
And this is something like to go with physically based rendering for textures that, you know, that accurately reflect and refract light. So anything that makes the game look more realistic gets a big thumbs up for me.
Right. Okay. I can get behind that.
Yeah, and just and also hopefully not increasing the hardware specs for the game,
right?
Because this is groundbreaking tech, so it could go either way.
Well, thankfully, the point before is giving us 50% more more room to play with. So yeah.
Well, I don't think that is 50% more of total memory. I think it's just the memory used for dynamic
textures.
At
the moment. Okay, well, next.
And the last bit when it comes to graphics is shadow map caching system, which allows for many more shadow casting lights at once and avoids the need for baking shadows. Now, shadow baking is a technique used in map creation, which basically doesn't make the shadow a dynamic entity, but a separate layer in the texture.
Okay.
So basically, you're artificially shading a piece of geometry, so you don't have to render a dynamic texture shadow.
Right. Okay.
And I suppose this makes it cheaper to run actual dynamic shadows.
Gotcha.
Yay, okay. And that's apparently it for the graphics. Next up, design. Crusader Converter to Object Container Setup. That's also done.
That's part of the whole Mega Map thing, right? When they talk about Object Containers.
Yes, it is. Yeah. It is, yeah. Basically, just means that any entity is an object container that you can that can hold on inside other object containers, which can hold in on the inside other object containers, and so on and so forth, all the way down,
mm-hmm.
Like a big, you know, Russian nesting doll thing.
Okay.
And the mega map is done for the persistent universe. So persistent universe. The only things, well, the first, they only introduced a mega map for single player stuff,
mm-hmm.
which was the hangars and free flight.
Okay.
And then they introduced it for the multiplayer stuff, which was also Arena Commander mode and Star Marine, which is what we have now. But
right.
Crusader and Area 18 were still loaded in the old fashioned way, but apparently it's now done for the persistent universe as well.
Awesome. I mean, like, I'm not sure if the Mega Map thing was always scheduled or always planned for them to make the game work, but it's a good thing that it is there now. Of course, they had to kind of go back to what they already had with the Crusader map and then kind of like splice it to make it work with their new system. So that's, I guess, that's why that's taken time. But it's good to hear that it's ready, you know, for the 3.0 branch. Yeah.
I wonder just how long... or how short the loading times are going to be in the persistent universe. Yeah. We got like 6 to 10, maybe 10 seconds if it's a busy thing, mm-hmm. loading times for Star Marine. It's still over a minute for the persistent universe.
Mm. Well, I guess it's to be seen, you know? I mean, like, it's literally 6 seconds to get into a single-player match, like you mentioned before. I mean, like, they actually took out the loading screens for things like Star Marine because they were so confident with the mega map working. And it does work, but it's like, you know, 10 seconds or so of dead air before you get into the game. With Crusader, I don't know. I don't, honestly, it'd be really neat if it was 6 seconds. I'll still be very impressed.
Mm-hmm. I'll still be very impressed if they manage to reduce it by the same ratio that they did Star Marine and Arena Commander.
Right.
Which was from like 30 seconds to down to 6, so it's like to 20% only.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Awesome.
And just a little side note also, the power plants and shield generators, coolers, and the heat and power system for improved gameplay and conversion to item 2.0 breathe have also been completed.
So repeat that, sorry.
Power plants, shield generators, coolers, and heat and power systems. Mm-hmm.
So all the things that will basically make Arena Commander, dogfighting, all that kind of stuff, all the stuff that's been missing, all the stuff that you can see in other similar games like in Elite Dangerous to kind of like make the whole dogfighting thing, I guess, a bit more involved, is now ready,
so
which is
subsystem targeting.
Exactly. I don't think subsystem targeting, but subsystem
the damage at least.
Yeah, the subsystems themselves will now be doing the work, and I guess this is part of item 2.0. When people talk about item 2.0, I don't think it's an actual like module in and of itself, but I suppose this means the different parts of it.
It's a huge refactor of the entire of the way the entire game is put together.
Right, so this is more like part of item 2.0 is now ready for the 3.0 branch. Okay. So that's awesome. That's awesome. It'd be really cool to see how that works, you know. With the smaller ships, I'm not really sure just how much it will kind of affect you in a ship against ship kind of way. Sure, being able to reroute your power would be awesome, and being able to actually, you know, utilize your coolers and stuff. But in terms of aiming at enemy subsystems, I think that's something that'll probably be saved for later on with the larger ships.
Yeah, the larger ships I can see. Yeah, if you're hitting a Gladius, I mean, most of the time it's basically as big as your reticule. So, for smaller ships, I don't really see how targeting a subsystem. Although, if you're approaching it by EVA and trying to sabotage a little part of it, I think in that case, you should be able to either target or at least affect it.
Yeah. You know, that's something that I want to see. I'm not sure. I don't think it's actually been kind of confirmed or alluded to in any way. But with the whole item 2.0 thing and the fact that your subsystems will actually be doing stuff and you'll be able to basically put those things into your ship and make them work, it'd be awesome if you could find a ship that's landed, say, in Grimhex, where no one's really paying too much attention to what's on the landing pads, and then when they land their ship, you can have a look at say like their cooler, for instance, and sabotage it or something, you know. I think it'd be really
just
cool.
Take it
or take the ship, or I don't know, like apply like
no, just take the cooler.
Yeah. Someone's taking my rims, you know.
Well, it was something similar that happened to me in Elite Dangerous last time I played, and I kind of rage quit after that because it was the first time I lost my Python.
Right.
I got ganked, and they all went after my power distributor.
Right.
And once that was done, the entire ship just shut down.
That's tactics, you know. I mean, like, they're all working towards a common cause, and you know, it sucks for you.
Yeah, and then just left me to slowly sped away.
This one time, actually in Star Citizen, it was like a 2.0 patch or something, and I was in a what's it called again? The Cutlass, and these two M50s were after me, and they both took out the fat engines on either side. And then just let me drift off. You know, when you're actually able to target those things with your ship computer and make things a little bit more, I guess, concerned, you know, like that'd be awesome.
Yep.
Yeah.
And hopefully the system also brings about the ability just to disable the ship instead of just having to destroy it to disable it.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So, you know, what's the point of piracy if you have to destroy somebody to get at them instead of just disabling their thrusters and then, or disabling their weapons and have them be completely helpless against you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Moving on.
Moving swiftly on.
Yes. Onto their environment.
Mm-hmm.
The modular room system for procedural generation of planetary outposts, thank fuck, is done.
Okay.
That doesn't include the art assets, but I think the technology to run it is done.
Right.
So official outpost spawning system ready for mission designers.
So all the
good
nice nitty gritty stuff that we saw in the ATVs, all the sliders to make them work and all that kind of stuff makes you wonder how long ago those videos were actually filmed, or segments within the videos were actually filmed. But that's awesome how that it's ready, you know. It's awesome.
Yeah, and you got integrated outpost distribution to Planet Ed or Planet Editor, single outpost object preset. Yeah, cluster of outposts.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good one. So it, you won't, maybe there will be sites where it's not just a single building, but you'll see several buildings and then in a blooming colony, like we talked about in Fortnightly Frontier like two episodes ago.
Yeah, yeah.
And there's going to be a crash site mission. That's going to be cool. Hopefully it's the Javelin that we saw.
I wonder. I mean, like, for the Homestead demo, I mean, I guess they'll probably just repurpose that entire area for multiplayer rather than building something.
Oh, that's going to be, that would be cool. One team playing the Nomads, one team playing, like, Explorers or Marines or just, you know, Mercenaries.
Always wondered how those missions would work. I thought it would be really cool if, depending on your, like, your orientation within the game, like, you'd be able to say, hey, I want to focus on doing more bad guy stuff. I want to focus on being a good guy. And then basically one quest chain would have two heads for which you could go through into it. So you could either do the whole, like, you know, talking to Eckhart thing, or you could talk to Eckhart again, and he'll send you into like the Starfarer to be the bad guys trying to stop the good guys.
Mm.
It's very similar in my head to what we already have. When you're an outlaw in the Persistent Universe right now, the baby PU, you get missions saying stop Acetotex, and Acetotex is just the name of a player character right now. So you have a mission to stop the players from turning on those satellites. I hope that when the mission system comes out, they'll basically just make that more compounded, more like, I guess, more deeper, you know what I mean? So, like, my only worry is that for the missions where you are meant to be the bad guy stopping the good guy, it might be a lot of just waiting at a terminal for an hour or so until somebody eventually shows up, whereas, you know, doing something actively.
Well, if it's only players, then yes, but NPCs should be able to...
That's true, that's true.
...bridge that gap.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And also, you mentioned a Starfarer instead of Javelin. I remember a while ago when they, in their one of the first demos of Planetary Tech, they showcased a crashed Starfarer instead of a Javelin. So could be a Starfarer, could be a Javelin, could be something completely different.
Well, I mean, we know that they have the broken models for both of them. But I was thinking of the Homestead demo. Was it just before or just after there was a Starfarer that they went to as well?
No, that was pieces of the Javelin.
I know, yeah, pieces of the Javelin, the crashed Javelin. But they also went to find the Dragonfly within the Starfarer.
Oh,
that's what I was thinking.
Right, no, yeah. that was, oh, right, no.
That was the Gamescom demo, not the CitizenCon one, yeah.
Oh, right, yes.
Mm.
Well, we did get those Starfarer derelicts in game.
Indeed,
so
yeah.
They're in the Asteroid Belt.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, moving swiftly on, otherwise this video is going to take like 6 hours. Also included in this modular room system, blah, 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 is the interface to hand place modules and safe tool here, and interface to teleport the camera to the closest outpost. I'm guessing the first one is basically just a quick way to save the location and orientation of objects and outposts.
Okay.
In a simple way. An interface to teleport the camera to the closest outpost. What would that?
So interface benefit? Because
teleport the camera to the closest outpost.
I don't know. It might be an internal thing. It might be one of those things. So you know how when you die in the persistent universe, like your camera is in third person looking at your corpse, and then it has to teleport to the med bay. I guess it's a similar thing there.
Oh, okay. So it just basically just teleports to the closest one, not to the spawn point.
Again, it might just be back end stuff that they decide to tell us. Which
we don't know. We have so much information, but we want so much more information about the stuff. So. Next up, area boxes created by artists. All room sizes are now usable in the outpost procedural system. Moving on.
Okay.
No, I had no idea. Maybe I should have read these before we started. Entrance room system working. Stairs and reps are now available as initial rooms. Okay. So I suppose that's to do with the outposts. How you get from the ground into on the actual floor of the outpost.
Okay.
So they automatically generate and be the proper length and shape. So you don't have to adjust them for every single one.
Mm-hmm.
Rooftop prop system working for solar panel. So solar panels on roofs. Yay. Wall prop system working for additional prop variants. Props on walls, like posters and plaques we have in hangar, maybe.
So repeat that. Sorry, I don't have this list up. Wall props.
Okay. Wall prop system working for additional prop variants.
Right. So I guess
this is all part of the modular room system for outposts.
Yeah. So I guess to do with item tipo. Not sorry, the item port system, like you have in the hangar as well, maybe.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. So, material wear / dirt on props using layer blend done and actually working. It says actually working.
I mean, was it not actually working when they were showing this to us on Around the Verse?
Yeah, maybe it was working in editor, but not in the actual game.
Right.
I suppose maybe if they manually moved the sliders, it worked. But having it pick up variables from the environment and applying them, maybe it didn't work.
I wonder.
And
like
now it does.
When people say actually working, I mean, like, is that a snarky kind of remark from one of the devs? Because it took them a long time. They hate this bug, and it's in there, freaking goddamn feature. Or anyway.
Ah, could be. Next one, outpost feet system. So the outposts are going to be on stilts.
Yes, they are going to be on stilts. They mentioned, they're going to be on stilts, and there are going to be staircases going
in
up towards
them. In case of flooding.
Yeah.
It's basically just a way for them to tackle uneven terrain.
Yeah.
So they don't have to modify the terrain. Because this is what you would do. You would either find a flat piece of terrain, or you would use some sort of terraforming technique to make it flat before plopping down an outpost. But I suppose with their current tech, it's kind of, I suppose this is an easier way instead of blending the terrain to match the floor of the outpost.
I mean, this is a technique that already exists in Mass Effect Andromeda and also in No Man's Sky.
For stilts.
They're stilts. Because otherwise, what would happen is that these buildings would be clipping through the terrain.
Yeah, I know, but but then you would take some sort of tool to level the terrain.
So you either go the roundabout way of actually having to make this terraforming fixer, or you just stand them up.
Yeah, maybe we'll get actual blending later on, but for now, I suppose stilts are an easier way.
Suppose.
Yeah. Next up, set random rotation and offset caps on planet editor. So this is, I think for planets, or no, random rotation. Oh, right. So the outposts aren't always aligned like north-south.
Okay.
But can go in different positions, so it's slightly less repetition, especially if you have several houses next to each other.
Mm-hmm.
I just hope it doesn't look too random and janky, and so it doesn't make any sense whatsoever.
Well, I mean, like, if you're looking for random and janky in ATV, when they were just showing you how many settlements they could have at once, that was random and janky, so I guess...
That was random and janky, yeah. Okay. Poof. Start documenting three possible map layouts looping system using 2 or 4 meters metric system using connection. What?
Moving on.
Moving on. Yeah, I think this is basically just different ways a outpost can be rendered using the same preset.
Right. Yeah. A lot of these features that are currently ready are a lot more back-end stuff as opposed to actually being interesting for the layman.
Oh, and if you're hot, support for aircon / solar panel system in outposts.
All right. Yeah, yeah. I was like, what? If you're hot?
So, yeah. But if that is a thing, that would mean that atmosphere effects would be a thing. So if it's too hot, you would be uncomfortable. Maybe your stamina reduces.
That's something I hope that they don't skimp on with all these planets and the different terrains and all that, how they would affect the character. I'll be so sad if say for instance you're in a planet like Mercury, if it wasn't super hot and you didn't have to have the right gear, or you had to have the right precautions for it. The same with really cold planets as well, having to have the right gear, having to all that kind of stuff, radiation. I'd be sad if they skimped on it.
Because Mass Effect 1 had it already, and No Man's Sky has it, so I don't see why not. Next up, added color tinting interface to planet ad. So this is like a back-end thing just to make terrain different colors already in the planet editor. Instead of having to go into the actual editor and paint it there. Because from what I've seen, planet editor is basically just a top-down view with circles and circles.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
That's a simple way of putting it, yeah.
Yep. Created material distinction for interior exteriors. Okay. So before it was all a single thing.
Mm-hmm.
Like the outside wall was the same as the inside wall, but now it's like slightly different. Creature comforts.
Why do we need to know this?
I don't know. Next up, group elements offset in planet object preset to be able to offset landing pads. Something to do with landing pads. And that's it for mining, for outposts. Wow. Moving swiftly on. The tools. The solar system editor is done, yes, obviously, because it also can paint sand.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Performance. Yay. This will be interesting for people who are interested in this sort of thing.
This would be interesting for people who are interested.
Which is about everybody. Which is just about everybody who wants Star Citizen to run faster. But this one isn't. Maybe they're just bundling performance and mechanics into the same thing.
Right.
Because the first item is the new light controller for runtime light switches, which was like a demo they showed for the interior of the hull. C, was it? Which was the hull that they showed last?
Hull C.
Hull C, yeah. So you had lights going on and off in patterns and stuff like that. So yeah, so they have mechanic that lets them program how lights turn on and off.
I mean, even the Javelin bridge as well, when they had the Eckhart-ish guy walking across it. Eckhart-ish.
Yeah, just poof.
I mean, what do we call all those Eckhart like models in the game now? Eckhartites, just because you can even be him in Starmarine if you go into third person. It's funny,
really.
Yeah,
Nice. Ecartians.
Ecartians, yes.
And new network message queue to reduce network bandwidth and network thread time. So that's still not network LOD or bind unbind, as it's called. This one is something we'll talk later if we actually get to it. It's just a slight upgrade to the current netcode, and hopefully it's a good thing and does actually reduce network thread time.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe a few skip through a few of these.
Skim read them.
Dynamic physics grid to support sparse space areas versus dense areas like space stations. Mm-hmm. Okay, so you have huge space versus where nothing happens, so they take up less memory, I suppose.
Right.
A highly optimized vertex and position format for all geometry. Well, optimizations.
I mean,
yay.
If you want to like just talk about features that people would be interested in, I mean, we could go back to the schedule citizen thing and then just talk about those, because mm-hmm. I think they're condensed into just like, oh, that'd be awesome. Oh, that'd be cool. So it's up to you.
You know what?
Yeah.
Why not? Why not? Why not? Because this is a long list.
It's super technical.
Yeah, it's super technical and it's a long list. So yeah, let's just go to that one. Yeah. Okay.
All right, so
well, the very first one, mm-hmm. the very first item, moons, done ages ago.
They were done 2 weeks ago, apparently.
Yeah,
that's ridiculous. So the moons Deimos, Stellion. What's up?
I don't see it.
What?
I don't see the schedule.
Oh, right. You mean on the thing? Oh, it's because it's so tiny. But
I know. But why not?
Yeah,
why not?
Fair enough. I got my cursor.
It's for them to look at something else other than our ugly mugs.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Mm. Say moons mm-hmm. done 2 weeks ago. So all of it?
I assume so, because they're just like round balls of dirt, you know. Although they're not just that in this game, they have tunnels and they have like geysers and all that kind of stuff. Each moon has its own kind of characteristic, and you know, like the underwater caverns of Yella, for instance. So
you keep mentioning that, but is it actually in the game or is it just a piece of fluff?
It better be in the game, otherwise I'm gonna find a fool.
But yeah, there was a tweet by the official Star Citizen Twitter account asking them what's the feature we are looking forward to most in 3.0, and I just replied, I want to get into my constellation,
mm-hmm.
fly down to Yella, land on a flat piece of ground, walk up a hill so I can get a good view, sit down and wait for the sunset.
And then they'd be like, sunset's coming in 4.0.
No, we will get to that.
Oh, yeah?
We'll get to that.
Okay.
Anyway, yeah, so moon's done. Surface outpost, which is basically what we were just talking about, that is scheduled to be done beginning of June, June 2nd. So there's a lot of stuff still to do, even though there's a lot of stuff that they've already done.
Yeah. So they made a start on Mission Givers as well. So they started that.
Eckhart is going to be one of them. And I forget who the other dude is. There are going to be two Mission Givers.
Tessa made Person.
Like, it was not Tessa. And do you think it's actual people, NPCs, that we get to interact with, just like in the Gamescom demo? Or will it be just someone other than Tessa?
I think that,
because they did mention Eckhart.
I think the Mission Givers is pretty broad. They might have Eckhart in there. They might have, I mean, I don't know. I'm not sure if the whole PMP, looking at your thing and the quest givers on your screen, I don't think that's going to be part of this. So if it is, awesome. Mm. But the way I see it, maybe, yeah, sure, Eckhart would be part of this, but also just random other quest givers, you know, like Tessa. But different, you know, just for all the different bits of content we're going to get. You know, I feel like it's going to be all part of that. But I do believe that Eckhart has been confirmed.
Yeah, and hopefully Tessa gets more content.
Yeah.
Or just different lines.
So, like you were saying before, derelict ships, they're should be somewhere through that now.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And, well, somewhat, yeah. You can see the red line. The red line is where we are now.
Yes.
It's today. And so it's about 3/4 of the way through. The schedule should be updated on Friday.
Okay.
So this might change.
Right.
Although I don't know how diligent they will be with the updates. Mm-hmm. Who knows?
Yeah.
But yeah, definitely interesting to see other things on the moons except for geysers.
Yeah. So the reason why I like how broad these are is that we can kind of like talk about them a bit more. Like, so for instance, derelict ships. So we've seen the derelict Starfarers. We've seen the derelict Javelin, at least in some sort of...
I take your point.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. But, but like, is that it? What about derelict Auroras? Why not?
Yeah.
You know, like, what do you think? Do you think they'll just do cap ships or whatever? Or do you think they'll be, like, the smaller, like, hulls as well? Because the derelicts that we've seen so far in the BBPU are just, like, weird-looking off-cut gladiuses and stuff, right?
Yeah, yeah, they are. And then there's the very recent Starfarers, and that's it.
Mm. Next up is debris fields. So,
just more expansive fields of debris. Like, you have clusters of debris right now, but maybe, you know, more expansive, more maybe dynamically generated, so it's not the exact same thing every time.
Right. So a debris field would be more like what? Like the Ring of Viela?
Like the gladiuses.
Oh, right. Okay. Gotcha. So,
you know, yeah, just derelict stuff.
Debris. I see.
Well, I don't know if asteroids count as debris.
Okay. So
I think debris is more man-made trash.
So this is probably where our auroras and all that kind of stuff will end up being.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
all right. Yeah. I got you. So next up
is Delamar Levski stretch goal. And I think every time stretch goal is mentioned in this, it's something they hope to do, but it's not crucial for 3.0. If everything else is done, but these stretch goal items aren't, I think they might still release 3.0 and then move these items to 3.0.
Is that a given? I mean, like, or is it an actual stretch goal? As in, like, is it an actual stretch goal from Kickstarter? Because one of those would incense people more than the others. Like, if there was if right here it says, oh, it's a stretch goal, but it's a stretch goal from Kickstarter, people would be like, oh, okay, it's a stretch goal from Kickstarter, it's still a feature. But then, we're going to see this later on, but there's something in the netcode and it has stretch goal written in it. And I feel like a lot of people will say, why is netcode being given second fiddle here if it's a stretch goal? You know what I mean? Mm. Yeah, but
you think one way, I'll think it the other, and
all right.
Maybe I think we should just go through the list.
I'm over here, you're over there.
Yeah. And moving up to gameplay.
So they're 24% of the way through the current things that they have listed here for gameplay.
Yep. And the first item on the list is pick up and carry.
What do you think that means?
So, well, I don't think it could be explained any more succinctly as it is, like, picking up stuff and carrying them.
Ah, I see. Okay.
Yes. Like, in the demo they showed, you had a helmet under your arm. Or you could throw it, that sort of thing.
Awesome. Yeah. So we saw that in the last week's video.
Mm. Yep.
Do you think it's just going to be... So we've seen this this kind of tech, I guess, in Helion as well. How much more detail do you think it'll be in that compared to this?
Yeah, that's a good question. Because, at least here you have the ability to interact with surfaces and rotate the objects before setting them down.
Right.
And if you pick up something, that's the same thing as in Helion. You decide whether you want to make it part of your inventory or not.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, but it would be nice to interact with these things.
Yeah.
Everything has so far only been very static, and you could only interact with guns and picking them up. Yep. And just making them a part of you instead of interacting with an item that you could then set down somewhere else.
Right. Okay. All the way towards the end, just before release, they have repair. So repair is something that I guess is already kind of in the game in some kind of way. When they say repair here, do you reckon it means like players actually repairing the ship, or do you mean it? Do you think it just means kind of tweaking what they already have?
I think tweaking, considering how tiny that little fraction of the thing is, because I don't think they can do in 3 days what we want them to do, like create an entire mechanic where you grab your, you know, handheld welder, go to a broken item, and, you know, and repair it. Although, why not?
Yeah, I mean, perhaps it's asking too much from that tiny, tiny square. You know, it's just this thing here. So, yeah.
Because, you know, it's basically a reverse pistol.
Mm-hmm.
It's still a pistol. You aim it and you shoot, but instead of giving something more damage, it's giving it less damage.
Mm-hmm.
It may be that simple.
Right.
May as well be that simple.
Okay.
But who knows? Yeah.
So, player man turrets?
Yeah, refactor to make them actually
fun.
Work.
Not just work, but Yay. Fun.
Yes, yes, that one. Yeah. Because they are actually making a game, not, you know, work simulator.
Mm-hmm.
Make something fun.
Exactly. Yeah. Atmospheric entry game code. So from what we saw in the previous demos, making that actually, you know, like better, I guess, than what it was.
Or maybe it has to do with... Oh, nice, this is atmospheric entry. It's not actual deorbit. Because I was thinking that speed-wise, you're not locked to the surface of the... to the speed of the surface on a surface when you are in orbit. You are doing something much faster.
Yeah.
But still, even if your speed is zero, you have to orbit to not just plummet directly to the planet.
Mm-hmm.
But if it's just atmospheric entry, I suppose it's all the effects of the rumbling and the way the ship behaves when it's transferring from vacuum into a gas.
Yeah. Okay. So next up,
it changes between vacuum flight model to atmospheric flight model.
Okay. I can dig that. So yeah. Next up is...
This one you like, the next one you like.
Yes, that's why I'm moving on, man. That's operator seats. Operator seats is the next one. I've been waiting for this for a long time. Just multi-crew in every single shape and form is just what I am for this game. It's why I got this game, you know, like... Because I've been so into, like, bridge simulators before that. With Star Trek Bridge being a thing now, and... now being like,
do you need VR for that?
I don't
please
know.
Tell me you don't need VR for that.
I hope not, but with that now being a thing, and there's more hype for it, the Star Citizen has to deliver, has to be on par or better.
So yeah, and hopefully all the things that we talked about, like the captain being able to dictate what seat does what
exactly,
and then the operators of those seats being just relegated to those specific functions.
Mm-hmm. Agreed. There's not really much else I can say about that apart from it. Better be there, better be fun, better be good. Or else.
Yeah. And next up is radar system.
Radar system, yes.
Radar system, yeah. I wonder if that's scanning as well, or if it's just a... working on the radar that we already have right now. You're just basically the ball in the middle of your dashboard.
I think it's probably just a refactor of that ball, because that ball is for all... I mean...
Is balling.
The ball means well, but it could be better. So it'd be awesome to see what they do with that and how they make it work. I mean, I believe it might also have to do with different kinds of radar, because you know how you mentioned before, like the close range radar is 360, but like long range is going to be more conular.
Yeah, so. Well, that's something to do with scanning. Yeah, the actual active scanning pings, at least the way I remember it. Yeah, when you have the shortest range, you can see everything around you, but very close to you. And then when you want more range, you have to focus the beam.
Yeah.
So the longer your range, the less peripheral vision you get.
I mean, like, if these kind of like work times for these things have any kind of indication to how much time and effort's being put into them, I'm kind of hopeful for radar. Mm. They're spending a pretty healthy amount of time on it. That being said, yep. You know, like, they have also spending a lot of time on turrets. So thank goodness, man. Thank goodness.
Yeah.
All right.
Next up, inventory system, game code engineering support. So
the inventory system, the thing that should have been in the game when you could buy clothes.
Yeah.
I was so confused when you could buy clothes and you couldn't, there was nothing. Yeah.
And I wonder how that is going to work, because at least from a visual perspective, like, how are they going to show you what you're wearing, apart from just looking down at yourself?
So, you know how I believe they did show it to us in 1ATV, but it's basically the holotable, that thing.
Okay, that's for Starmarine,
I mean, okay, sure, it's not diegetic in the least, you know. And I guess that's where you're coming from. It might just be like a huge, no, because that would suck, having to Grand Theft Auto style go into a booth and, you know, go into a booth, look at a mirror and do it that way. Because again, that's not diegetic. Yeah.
Nope. But then again, having to get naked, you know, a very lengthy procedure, or just, you know, taking clothes off and putting new ones on, it just takes time and saps the fun out of everything.
Right. Yeah, so it's awesome that that they're actually going about and they're making it for, you know, finally.
And it's gonna, if it's as powerful as the item port system for the ships, is gonna be great. Mix and match to your heart's content. You can be the ugliest and least color coordinated motherfucker as you can imagine,
dude. Fashion citizen's a thing, dude. It's gonna be a thing. I'll challenge you to my fashion. You know, you need to step up to my fashion. But yeah, it'll be interesting to see how they manage to make it diegetic and stuff with everything in the game. You know, definitely
making it fun. Mm. Yeah, just make it fun.
Yeah.
I would be willing to sacrifice a bit of 100% hardcore diegetic user interface if it means that it's not tedious.
Okay. Right on.
Wouldn't you?
Sure, but would it stand up to Chris's vision, though, is the question. You know, like, of everything having to have a purpose and not just be there for the sake of being easy to do. I guess we'll see.
We'll see. Yeah. Mm. Next up is the light control system, which we already talked about. Being able to control individual lights based on gameplay input instead of map controlled.
Yeah.
Which is great.
And it's cool that it's there and you can see it's not really going to take them that much time, apparently, if that's to be believed. It'll be awesome when it's done. You know, like the way that the guy walked into the bridge of the Javelin and the lights went on, it was so cinematic, you know?
Yeah, the good kind of cinematic as well.
Yeah, yeah, it was awesome. Mm-hmm. I can't wait to see more of that. I wonder how it'll work for most of the ship, you know? Like, is it something you'll actually be able to turn on and off? Or is it like you walk into the bridge and then the lights will turn on? Kind of like... How?
It would be cool if lights would turn off in empty rooms.
Yeah, exactly. Like in the business hangar or the what's it called now? The help me here. The
Air review
hangar. Yeah, you go inside the top room and then you open the door and everything comes to life and the chairs turn and circle towards you.
It makes
me think about that. Is that how it's gonna work, or is it gonna be you flick a switch? I guess we'll have to see.
Yep, we'll see. Next up is the cargo game code engineering. So yeah, cargo confirmed for 3.0 and we're getting it, and I know at least one gamer with not so saturated hair. Okay, that was horrible.
That was horrible.
That is going to be very happy about that. So finally being able to load up your ship with crates and moving them. I suppose this is part of the new mission system where they said there will be missions to ferry stuff from one place to another. Although I don't know how advanced that's going to be in 3.0, because unfortunately we're not getting the entire system. We're still being... cordon off to the Crusader and its moons.
Yeah, yeah, totally. Mm. It's awesome that it's there, and I can't wait for it. I can't wait to see their vision for cargo, basically. And I'm guessing this is going to also include things like the actual boxes being visual and physicalized and stuff like that.
Oh, so, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So I can't wait
and
for
that. And if you paid attention to one of the mock-ups for the shop kiosks, mm-hmm. in one of them said, Constellation loading time, 14 minutes.
Right. 14 minutes.
So it's going to take 14 minutes, for people to load up your Constellation with cargo. I hope maybe that's in-game minutes, which are going to run a bit faster than normal
Do you
minutes.
Reckon?
Well, there is going to be time dilation or stretching or shrinkage or whatever it is they're calling it.
Right. I don't think that that would work. I mean, I guess for us, if like it says minutes and it doesn't actually literally mean minutes. But that's ridiculous. I mean, unless there's other stuff to do. And I guess if you're going to Area 18, then you will have other things to do while your cargo is doing all that. So it does kind of make sense there.
Yeah, exactly. You can go shopping. You can go have a drink. Mm. You can go dance with the ladies. But, you know, GTA 5 has quite short days. Mm-hmm. And I don't find it that immersion breaking when minutes go by literally like seconds.
Sure, sure. I wonder if this will actually also include the box that you had in the demo last year, like being able to have smaller boxes and not just the pallets that you have with the cargo yeah. system. So, because in my mind, if you were to have a massive crew of people in your ship and you had some cargo, you know, I wouldn't put it past certain like players that you were to pick up to help you with a mission to maybe steal or pocket stuff. But if you had like some really super important stuff, I would like to keep it in like my special lockbox, and I'd like to carry that to like the bridge of my Starfarer, for instance, and lock that door so no one else can go inside, you know, where my like my special captain's reserve or see my
yeah, but that but that requires doors that can be locked, and I don't think that's in
you don't
that's
think
a big part of item 2.0. Mm. We'll see, we haven't gone through the entire schedule yet. Maybe it's down further on the list.
Right. Okay. Awesome.
Right.
So next up,
that's done. Mm-hmm. Fuel refuel.
Fuel refuel.
That's in flight.
In flight fuel that's refuel.
That's not landing on a landing pad and hitting a button in your mobile.
So like similar to an Elite Dangerous then, where like people can chuck like fuel at you, or what do you mean?
Either that or actually scooping up. I don't know. Mm. I don't know. I just know that it's not tied to a Cryte Astro.
Right. Okay. Next up.
Persistent damage, ammo, and missile count. Okay, so if you log out mm-hmm. with a damaged ship and you log back in, it's still going to be damaged.
That's such a good thing. I mean, I can't wait for this, because this will mean that when you're actually playing around in the verse and your ship gets damaged, you're not going to just go, oh, whatever, I'll just blow it up and get a new one at Port Olisar, or I'd relog mm-hmm. and do the same thing. I guess it'll stop griefing and kind of make the game much more immersive as a result.
Yeah, because that is also tied to a bit further down the list, insurance, mm-hmm. which is a refactor of the insurance. It's not going to be the same as it is now, mm-hmm. where you basically get the ship no matter what. Mm-hmm. You can pay for it to be expedited, but you will have to pay to get the ship back.
Right. Okay. So,
just like in Elite Dangerous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. There is, even though you have insurance, it's basically there to make it so you don't have to pay full price for the ship again.
Okay.
But just a fraction of it.
Right. Right on. Okay. So next up is power supply and pipes, and that goes back to item 2.0 as well.
Yeah. Yeah.
So pipes, so is that pipes that can actually be destroyed and stuff as well?
Yes. Yeah. Yes, there's physical pipes going from the power plant to the thrusters, or from the engine mm-hmm. to the thrusters, and from the power plant to different subsystems. And if you sever those,
Right.
You put it out of the commission.
I think that'll make more sense, or at least it'll be more apparent when you're in a larger ship as opposed to being in, like, again, an Aurora. Because by the time you've lost pipes in an Aurora, you've got, like, maybe 10 seconds before you're going to Davy Jones's locker or space locker or I don't even know.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Davy Jones's Starfarer.
Indeed. But with a larger ship where your ship has more hit points and stuff, this becomes more apparent. I think that's also where you're going to have to see things like repairing and stuff happening as well.
Yeah. Because, you know, if your thrusters go out, it may be the entire thruster is blown off, but it could be just the pipe connecting it to the engine has been crimped or has a hole in it.
Right.
And you have to repair it, and then, you know, that's an easy fix.
Mm-hmm.
So, next up, quantum drive.
So that's done.
What? Well, yes, but quite recently, although we've had quantum drive in game for ages.
Yeah.
So what is it doing so recently on the list?
What is it doing so recently on the list? I guess it's making it not suck, making it so that when you have multiple people in the quantum drive in a ship, the ship doesn't bug out, making it so that, well, hopefully navigation, right? I mean, like, hopefully navigation is tied in there somewhere, because as cool as it is to turn somewhere and go, it kind of sucks that if there are many different things overlapping each other, it's kind of like anybody's guess where you're going.
Could be tied into a system map on the Mobula, so you can select it there, select the destination there, and then go. Yeah.
Also, one thing with quantum drive right now is that if you're going somewhere manually with a quantum drive, there is about maybe 3 or 4 seconds worth of stoppage time. But if you're quantum driving to a place that's preset, then there is no stoppage time. So maybe with this, it's going to be a bit more, I guess, wherever you want to stop is where you stop, you know?
Right. Okay. Maybe.
I guess. I hope that's just me and not my opinion, man.
Yeah. Next up, commodities.
Insurance, you missed.
No, we already talked about insurance.
Previously, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Commodities. Mm-hmm. That one. Maybe down part of the cargo and mission system. So, there's commodity-driven economy, like a region that's missing a commodity and a region that's rich in it will auto-generate missions to ferry stuff from one place to the other.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's going to be, well, tie in really, really, really importantly with the quest system and having to do all that kind of stuff. Things like goods and all that kind of I guess I say all that kind of stuff a lot, don't I? But yeah, goods for sure, and all that kind of stuff. Oh man, definitely though, definitely.
Hopefully it's that. I can't see what else it could be.
It must tie in with that, with missions of that nature, like in, for instance, Elite, where you have.
Yeah, but it's a very short little segment of time that they've given it. As opposed to the next item, which is stamina, which is from 2 weeks ago until almost the very end.
I guess with commodities, it's just kind of a list of, what else could we sell here? Aglets, that kind of thing. And then put a price to it. So it's not really that important.
An aglet is one of these.
I know.
Yeah, and stamina, very complex energy and recovery system for when you're on foot. Yeah, very, very... although they showed it that there's a fail state. Like, if you're too tired, you can't vault over
that
something.
That was hilarious, yeah.
Yeah, but... And I don't think it should be there. I think...
Really?
Well, you should be able to vault over whatever you want to vault over, but fall on your ass when you get over. At least,
I don't think that's how it works, Starch. I think if you're too tired to go up somewhere, you don't go up somewhere. You don't go up somewhere and then to have a smoke.
but it's a good thing. So yeah. we avoid people
running and gunning,
jumping
everywhere.
And running and gunning over. But yeah, getting the combat to be more natural and more tactical.
Yes. Definitely.
Instead of just running gun. Yeah. Less COD, more armor. Yay. Mm.
So, doors and airlocks. Airlocks. So, I'm not sure if that has to do with door security or anything, but that is a very long time of yeah, that's a very long production time.
Yeah, maybe it's the sort of thing that tied into the whole atmosphere system. Because right now, if you're not wearing a spacesuit and you go out an airlock, it is the airlock script that kills you. It's not the lack of oxygen.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Maybe. Although, just fixing the damn doors in the persistent universe would be nice, especially in Kovalex, because goddamn those doors.
Oh man, but if it is like a security, that'd be amazing. I would love for security to come in sooner than later, especially when you have new people coming in on free flights and they just like stow away in your ship, or like you get into your ship and somebody. It'd be really nice to lock people away. I know in the future of the game you'll be able to actually assign permissions to specific rooms within your ship, but I guess we'll have to wait and see here.
Yep. And the one that takes almost as long is Kyo's game code engineering, and that's to do with cargo and spare parts and stuff like that. So you can actually go into, what's it called? The shop that sells spare parts in Area 18 and on Port Olisar. What
Dumpers Depot.
Yeah, that one, yeah. So you can actually go there and, you know, interact with their inventory system and buy stuff, you know, maybe upgrade, or maybe yours is just damaged beyond repair and need to replace it. I just hope all of this switching from having an infinite supply of fresh ships to persistent damage isn't going to completely tank the gameplay. Like, you'll still have griefers that are just going to make it a nightmare for everybody because they'll destroy their ships, and those people won't be able to afford getting a new one anymore. And maybe they just need to up or lower the price of these things, or up the rewards for missions. So, you know, that part of it is going to require quite a lot of tweaking.
I guess
and balancing.
That's what we're here for, I suppose. You know.
Yeah, maybe that's why it's an alpha. Yeah.
All right. So I guess that's all for that. So next up is core technology.
Core technologies, yes, the backbone of the game. Planetary tech. Wait.
What's
okay,
that?
Okay, so the moons that are done. Mm-hmm. So I suppose that's just
I'll scroll
the
up.
Moon.
So the moons are PU content. So that is PU content, and that's been done. Then then we have where are we? Not that.
Slightly up in the orange. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Then planetary tech itself. I'm not sure what that entails. Maybe actually like things like orbiting and all that kind of stuff, maybe.
Or maybe just being able to go on that, because if the moon art asset is done, it doesn't mean you can actually walk on it.
Right.
And land on it, and it's being spherical with the gravity being spherical and stuff like that. So that could be just making the art assets work as intended.
Okay. Right on.
Solar system tool we talked about, that is circles within circles for easy organization and setting up of solar systems.
Right.
Good. Yeah. Entity update component shader. Can we scroll over this? Does it say anything? Nope. Sometimes the tooltips have a short explanation. Not this time around.
No, it just tells you entity update component shader. So I have no idea what that means. So we're going to move on.
Yep. entity owner manager.
No idea. It's just core technology. All you need to know is it's going to be done and it's going to make things work. So I guess next up for us anyway is UI. So a whole bunch of different UI needs to be made.
Zen Bien and his team working hard and being bosses.
So kiosk UI for all the shops and stuff we talked about. Inventory system UI for the inventory you talked about. So all these things are separate. I don't think these are sprints in and of themselves, are they? They're just things.
Well, they are part of the is it Frankfurt or Manchester? I think Manchester, where the UI team is predominantly located.
Right.
And it's not the gameplay part of it; it's the visual interaction part.
I see. Yeah,
of everything that we've seen so far.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to take quite a while, inventory system.
So
and hopefully they get it.
Yeah.
Done.
So
and right.
Yeah. So item 2.0 UI as well, what we've just been talking about. So I'm guessing that's not only just for the ships, but also for the players and their equipment as well. So that's being worked on. It's got a long ass.
It's the little item subset, you know. So you don't have just a control panel. You have every button that you can highlight, and it'll pop up what you can do with it. That sort of thing, which at least in the short videos I've seen is a huge upgrade to what we have now.
Right.
Because still, they removed the whole use in brackets thing and replaced it with nice floaty text. But it's still pixel hunting.
Yeah.
It's still fucking pixel hunt in a lot of cases. And you have to, nope.
Yeah. So,
oh, there you go. Yeah.
We'll see just how much easier it is when the patch comes out anyway. So next up, Mr.
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yes.
Yep. So a lot of people are super happy for this one. I've seen a lot of people who've tried to get into Star Citizen have to stop because they were about to throw up because a lot of people aren't able to deal with set FOVs and they need to adjust them to how their eyes and their brains work. So it's great to see that this is in. It's been a while coming.
And the implementation they showed is very promising.
Indeed. It was a bit of a difficult one for them to get going. But once somebody found out a trick or whatever, it's good. It's awesome.
Yep.
Because how the helmets and stuff work right now, the UI, you know, it's all static. So somebody found a way to allow you to increase and decrease the FOV while making those different elements like resize and not look weird.
And I think Mark Abund has mentioned what it is, and it's something that I knew had to be done.
Mm-hmm.
Is basically moving the camera backwards and forwards in the head.
Okay.
So, because when you're looking out the helmet and you see the edges, this is what you want to keep static. So if you change the angle, if you just change the angle, so you're gonna look either more narrow and not see it, or wider and see a lot more of the helmet.
Okay.
So to avoid that, you have to move the camera forward and backwards. So once the edge of vision gets to the helmet, it's always the same part.
Right.
And then it does this. Instead of angle doing this, it goes. It's really hard for me to show with hands. It'd be nice to have graphs, but. Yeah, whoever figured it out, thank you.
All right, so next up is character customization. So again,
Go ahead.
I was going to say, so again, it'd be awesome to see how they actually implement this diegetically in such a way that will actually make sense.
Yeah, well, I don't think the first step is going to be very diegetic. It's going to be part of the same system that we've seen for clothing, change of clothing, but you'll also be able to change your head and use the same sort of sliders as we saw for the trilateral demo.
Right. I guess it would make sense in this respect then to make it in a similar way to they do the Arena Commander customization. It'd just be a page like that for now.
For now, yeah.
There is a bit of a spoiler, and I'm not going to go any further than that, but they've actually leaked exactly how character customization was going to work in the released game.
I think I've read that, and it was like that was like over a year ago.
Yeah, but enough on that. They probably
and that was for Squadron 42, wasn't it?
Yeah, but if your character carries on, then you know it'd be the same thing.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Okay, next up, personal manager app. No idea what that is. So I think these apps
are part of your MobiGlass, right?
MobiGlass stuff, and hopefully the MobiGlass will get the refactor that we've seen like several months ago already.
So it's actually I'm skipping down now really quickly, but the MobiGlass overhaul thing that we see here, they say that the Mobiglass overhaul itself is a stretch goal. And now my source is telling me that stretch goals in this respect and previously as well basically mean that features that would be nice to have, but they're not going to be blockers if they're not ready by June.
So it is the stretch goal, that the version of stretch goal that I alluded to.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah. And,
but it is not... It's not slated until 29th of June, so hopefully it'll be done.
Sure, yeah. So with those things, we have the Personal Manager app. So I guess I'm again, I'm guessing like quick inventory looking and that kind of stuff. Your money, your missions, perhaps as well.
Okay.
So Cargo Manifest would be awesome to have as well. You know, a bit of Tetris never hurt anybody.
Well, I suppose. Really, Cargo Manifest app, and it's basically just game of Tetris.
Mission
that probably just lists your ships and what cargo they have.
Mission board app, I'm guessing, would that be player missions, or would they be?
I think that's a mission tracker.
Okay,
just that. Now it's in journal now, but it's going to be moved onto the mission board. Or maybe it's even being able to receive missions. It'll just go to the mission board and pick missions you want without having to go to the job board on Area 18.
Right on. Star Map app.
The Star Map app I want.
So this would actually be super awesome. This is, I assume, is the merging of the Star Map app from the website to the game. Because it's meant to be this thing that's actually like real time, and things that do change within the verse will actually also change within the Star Map app. So it's awesome that it's here.
It'll help with navigation. So you don't have to look around you for where you want to go, just... I also hope it's not just a top-down view of the source system, but also a hierarchical view.
Right. Be cool.
So it's easy to find. Yeah. I mean, both would work, but I think having the option to choose between the two is even better.
Would be awesome. It would be, yeah. So UI owner component for items. What do you think that means?
It could be just the way the Mobiglass is organized.
Okay.
So you can have windows within windows within windows.
Right. Okay.
Does the tooltip say something?
UI component for items. It does not say zilch. Cargo user interface, so different from the actual manifest. The actual cargo user interface, I believe, will be similar... I guess that's...
That's for ships, not for Mobiglass.
Yeah, so for instance, within the Starfarer, there's a terminal that overlooks your cargo bay, so I'm guessing that'll be where this is. So this is slated much later in development in this small cycle scale thing, but I can't wait to see what this looks like, man. Man, 3.0 is...
There's a lot of things that are coming.
It's teasing to be something fierce, dude.
Yeah.
Something fierce. All right, so Mobiglass overhaul we just talked about. Mission Manager app. So how does this change? How does this differ, this app?
I suppose mission board then means it's an app where you can get missions, and the Mission Manager is tracking your active missions. So you have all the journal entries that you got and the next point in the mission that you need to go to and stuff like that.
Okay. All right, so next up is AI. They have two ones here. They have a mission system AI. So what is that again, Dodge?
Mission system AI. AI-generated missions, maybe?
I think it's more along the lines of, like, you're doing a mission, and there's some sort of intelligence that's basically directing you towards your mission. And
So it's not just like a predetermined script, but it throws curveballs at you.
Conditional events and all that kind of stuff, yeah. AI turrets, I guess, is on the tin, right?
So it's basically, there's been three ways of controlling turrets. One is player control, other is NPC control, and the third is AI control. And the AI is like an upgrade to your ship's computing unit.
Okay.
So the normal one is basically just your standard bog standard stuff, just barely enough to run the ship. Mm. But if you get an advanced one, it would get different upgrades, one of them being turret AI, so it can control the turret on its own.
Okay.
Not as well as, say, a player, a trained player, or a trained NPC would.
Right.
But still, if you're flying solo in, say, a Vanguard and you're attacked and you would really like to have the guns on the turret help, it can help.
Right on. Okay. So next up is Giraffics.
Giraffics, yes. I like Giraffics. They make things pretty.
Indeed. Render to texture. What does that mean? What do you think it means?
Render texture is the very first thing we talked about. And
okay, let's skip it then.
but this is weird. Because
it said it was done, didn't it?
It said it was done already.
In that case, it probably is done, you know?
So why does it say it's going to be done?
Well, that's the thing with how these schedule reports are made. Like, internally, they say, okay, we want this thing to... Well, this thing will be done around maybe June this time around. And so that's what somebody said. That's why it's there. But then when they were writing up, doing the write-up, it was already done. The same way the Buccaneer got released so much earlier than the actual Cutlass.
Yeah, there could be a lot of inconsistencies about this. Yeah. Okay, so let's just move on then. Mm-hmm. Live environment probe capture. So that's for live reflections in visors or in shop window glass and stuff like that.
No more cube maps? Is that a thing in CryEngine?
Well, it's a thing in CIG's jacked up lumberyard engine.
I didn't think that was going to be a thing. So basically, a cube map is just like, I guess
it's a capture. It's you put a 360 camera at a point in a room, and it takes a photo, and then that photo is applied kinda ish to all the reflective surfaces in the room. For easy reflections.
So,
but if this is live environment probe capture,
that's ridiculous. So, like, So for people who are watching, like, you know, when you probably know more, most people here know more about this than I do. But like, you know, when you're going to like a shop in like a GTA or in Star Citizen, for instance, and you go look at some glass, you might see the reflection of what's supposed to be behind you, but it may not be exactly where things should be. Like, for instance, you won't see any of your other friends in the reflection, and like there might be a store behind you that doesn't exist. So with this is actually, wow, that's ridiculous. That's actually going to be...
I really hope it is.
Okay, now you're saying you really hope it is. So now, man.
Well, there's no tooltips. It doesn't explain it. And from my understanding of the engine nomenclature, that is what it's going to be.
Man, okay, all right, okay. Now I'm cautiously optimistic instead of happy. All right.
So, I'm hyped up.
All right. So engine trails and contrails. So this is something that we saw in ATV. I feel this is going to help a lot with the, oh my God, where did my target just go kind of thing.
Exactly. Mm. Yeah. It will give other ships more presence. Mm-hmm. So it's a lot easier for you to find them. Even if they're like... Because with the new scanning system, you may not be able to see them. Your system may not be able to see them, but you will, because you'll see the contrails.
Exactly.
Or the chemtrails, as some people on the internet would like you to believe.
Volumetric fog has been done.
Mm.
And so has, GPU particle effects have already been done, and I guess that's part of volumetric fog and contrails.
And volumetric fog, I hope that's also something that they can apply to clouds.
Right.
Mm-hmm. The cloud texture, so you get, like, volumetric clouds, really fluffy, you know, grab out and caress them sort of type of clouds instead of just textures.
Drabby hands comes back just for that.
Yes. And atmospheric entry graphics are being worked on, so it'll be apparently a revamp of what we saw in the Gamescom demo, which was good, but I immediately noticed that it could be better.
Right.
Every
slave over a hot Photoshop and stuff, and this is what you do. Could be better.
Could be better.
Oh, man. Yeah.
5 out of 7.
So back-end stuff now. The solar system shop service. So I'm guessing this is tying in all the different stores within everything else. So yeah. It's all intermeshed. And so like they can give you missions that say, hey, we need more stuff. Mm. Go to here to get it. And there's a mission there.
Yeah. So, So there's actual inventory and there's actual shortages mm-hmm. and oversupply.
That is ridiculous.
And then.
Mm. Yeah. Solar system mission service. So again,
tied to the shop service.
Mm-hmm. And diffusion subset for 3.0.0. No idea. I'm going to keep moving on. Network, new message queue.
New message queue. Yeah, that is
I'm not a dentist.
What? To do with how messages are ordered and sent to be more efficient.
Okay. And physics and serialization.
I hope just optimizing. Well, because you have to not just you have to sync up the way physics works on client different clients in multiplayer. So,
okay.
Because there is some chaos theory applied to it. So even though starting positions may be identical, the outcome may not be the same every single time something happens
right.
when you apply a physics system. So you still have to sync it up so everything does happen on every client at the same time.
So basically it makes the lag gooder.
Yes.
Okay. All
hopefully.
Right. Okay.
And this is the big one. This is the big one. And this is not even, it's a stretch goal
mm-hmm.
and it's extended all the way to the end and in beyond 3.0.
Right.
If you actually look at the 2017 full schedule, this thing does actually go for several more months.
Right.
That is what a big effort it is to accomplish. And that is the big network, I suppose, LOD system.
Mm-hmm.
Things that are far away are going to be culled. So you won't get the information about them all the time.
Mm-hmm.
The only information that you will get is of things that directly affect you.
Okay, right on. So it's basically when it's done, or if it's done, then it'll make things. Well, it'll solve a lot of our issues that we have with latency and stuff in the PU.
Yeah, exactly.
But no one's holding their breath, and it's being called a stretch goal here. So I guess whenever it's done, it'll be done. And once we get the Delta Patcher, which isn't listed here, then hopefully.
Well, yeah, the Delta Patcher, because the Delta Patcher is not part of 3.0.
Is it? So when is that coming in? Or is that just something random?
No, because it's a completely different project
right.
to Star Citizen.
Yeah.
It's an ancillary application that patches Star Citizen.
Okay.
This only deals with Star Citizen.
Gotcha.
This is also not. There's also nothing about Squadron 42 in here.
That's very true. Like, yeah. I mean, the less about that, the better until it actually comes out, you know, personally anyway.
Mm.
Looking forward to Gamescom for more information about all that kind of stuff. For sure.
And now we are at the last section.
Ships
which is
and
basically
weapons.
Just ships.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right.
Ships and weapons. So, Dragonfly, want, mm-hmm. have, want.
Have, want. Cutlass Black, have, want.
Don't have. I'll fly in yours.
No,
it's fine.
No dodges allowed. Constellation Aquila.
Yep. Hopefully get the loner when it's out.
Because
I do have the Andromeda now for McCarrick, and the Aquila would be a more appropriate loner.
Definitely. So I think it's probably...
Because it gets the Ursa. Just because it gets the Ursa.
Yeah, so with the actual progress bars as well. So, I mean, we're looking at the Cutlass Black taking a bit longer to be done than the Dragonfly. I don't think... Mm-hmm. I think these are two separate teams working on them. Matt Sherman's group was working on the Buccaneer beforehand, and now I guess the Cutlass probably has a few more things necessary to look at, things like the turrets and stuff. Making sure the turrets work will probably be a really big factor for when that comes out, when that's released.
And hopefully, with 3.0, we'll be getting the ability to tuck in the turrets from the Constellation, because now they're always extended and, you know, the cowlings are always open. But I would really like... You know, when they're not manned, just slide in, close, because it's really ruining the shape of the ship right now.
Right. The Ursa Rover is on this as well. It's going to be cool to drive around in that thing.
And it's two-seater, right?
Mm-hmm. the missed prospector has an even shorter dev time here.
Yeah, we saw it in an ATV.
We did. It's pretty much done. It looked amazing. I guess damage states and all that kind of stuff need to be done, or maybe even it's ready. What is the P8SC? Is that a weapon?
I think it's a handheld weapon, yeah.
Okay.
It's P8.
What did I say?
Well, it is the P8.
Yeah. Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Scourge rail. Ooh, that looks like it's taking a long time.
That's the because they also need to work on unless they have finished it, the system for shoulder mounted weapons. Because it's not a handheld. It's that big thing.
Right. Yeah. Okay, that thing's gonna be amazing. I mean, like, just touching on that a bit more, like, what do you think its purpose is going to be in the game? Is it for insta-giving troops, or is it for actually more deader? Makes things more deader. But do you reckon it'll be surface to air, like, or is it just for people?
Well, considering we have the sniper rifle, which is also an insta-give, but we don't have armor yet in the game.
No.
So maybe if you go against a heavy with a sniper rifle, even fully charged, it won't be a one-shot, one kill.
I mean,
but the railgun, maybe?
The railgun is held like an RPG, so I expect it to work like a space RPG, and so it should take down ships if you can hit them with it.
Well, yeah, but because even handheld weapons can do damage to ships. Mm. All the projectiles are physicalized, so once the bullet or energy pellet, whatever it is, leaves the barrel, it will damage whatever it hits, be it a player or a ship.
Mm. Even the players are
totally unprofessional.
Even the players are physicalized as well. I mean, there was a patch. I'm not sure if you can still do this, guys, but there was a patch where you could, like, basically dive bomb at ships as your player and headbutt a ship and make it explode. You're right there, Darge?
Phone dying, and I can't. Oh, thank God. There we go. It's really hard to disable an alarm when the phone's like 3% battery and it's just slowing down everything.
All right.
But what you were saying?
No, just saying, so you're talking about physicalized weapons and stuff, and I was saying how even the players are physicalized to a degree that a player, like, crashing into something at breakneck speeds can actually blow up a ship.
Mm. Yeah, and it's basically just handheld weapons have a lot less damage to them than ship weapons, so even though they do cause damage to ships, it's just going to take a longer time to do it. So that shoulder-mounted railgun, even though it's a player weapon, might do quite massive damage to a ship.
At the same time, maybe it won't, because for the ships themselves, they require, like, such huge and heavy power packs for them to do anything. So I think the same would be needed for some guy on the ground.
Maybe you get three shots.
All right. Okay, I can dig
it. Okay, the last three things, and then I think we should wrap this up, because this video's been going on for quite a while now. The Gallant Rifle, the Arrowhead Sniper, and the Devastator 12 shotguns are getting reworks.
So in terms of just graphical fidelity, or like how...
And reloading, and basically. I don't think they'll be changing their core functionality.
Right now, the Arrowhead Sniper Rifle is pretty overpowered. Like, I've used it quite a lot, and it's ridiculous. So I'd like to see how exactly they go ahead and rework that.
Well, the way that's happening, it's just a balance issue.
Mm, I see.
Although, one thing I would like to see that hasn't been mentioned is the way scopes work.
Right.
Because, so you have the energy rifle, and the attachment system. That would be cool to see. Because, you know, to be able to put the red dot sight just to any weapon.
That would be cool.
Red dots so much better than everything else. Mm. But if you have the scope, it doesn't actually zoom in, because it basically just narrows your field of view.
Mm-hmm.
Which is kind of shit. Well, because everything is just so realistic, and then they still using the age-old zoom in by narrowing the field of view instead of actually using like a projector screen on the top, on the back of the sniper and having that just go. It'd be cool. I don't know if it can be done, but the people working at CIG are magicians.
They are magicians, and they're going to spite you. They'll be like, we can do this, but we don't care.
But we won't. We could, but he badmouthed us, so nah.
All right, guys. So,
and just one thing I'd like to mention.
What's up?
A person that we like has mentioned that 3.0 will get mining.
Get mining?
But it's mining.
Okay. So to what degree?
Exactly. It's not on the schedule.
Ah, I see. Well,
so what happened?
Maybe it got missed. You know, maybe they were like,
yeah, it's a kilometer long schedule. Let's not make it kilometer and a half by actually adding all of these things.
And I'm sure by Friday there'll be an update and people will be like, oh, there's mining. And then people like Board Game will be like, oh yes, now I can talk about even more stuff. So it's content for everybody. It's great, you know.
Yeah. But anyway, this has been a hell of an episode, hasn't it?
It's been one of those days.
So yeah, it's been one of those days. Yeah. So shall we wrap it up?
Uh-huh.
Because we haven't even touched on the 2017 schedule. I think that we're going to have to do a separate video on that. But this has been running just far too long, so I think we're going to wrap it up right now. You want to do it, or should I?
Oh, you opened up, so I guess you can close before...
Oh, thank you.
You left all this
Thank you, everybody, so much for watching, both on YouTube and on Twitch. This has been Frontier Feature 6, where we dove in quite extensively into the schedule report for the upcoming hella sweet Star Citizen Alpha 3.0 patch. I have been your host, Darionator. Over there has been my good friend, Meyer. And we will see you in the verse.
Hella sweet, really? Hella sweet.
Hella sweet.